Still no progress in the ongoing Gaza ceasefire talks in Cairo. Hamas says it has rejected the latest proposal from Israel, which has not changed its position. A Reuters source says the deadlock continues over Israel's refusal to end the war, withdraw forces from Gaza, allow all civilians to return to their homes, and lift a 17-year blockade for the reconstruction of the enclave. Earlier on Monday, reports emerged that some progress had been made, with both sides making the concessions that could lead to a deal for a three-stage truce. Meanwhile, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says a date has been set for the invasion of Rafah. The city in southern Gaza is the last refuge for displaced Palestinians and the last holdout for Hamas combat units, according to Israel. U.S. President Joe Biden announces plans to ease student debt that would benefit at least 23 million Americans. The plans include canceling up to $20,000 of accrued and capitalized interest of borrowers, regardless of income, and automatically canceling the debt for borrowers who are eligible for certain forgiveness programs.
I will never stop to deliver student debt relief on hardworking Americans, and it's only in the interest of America that we do it. And again, it's for the good of our economy that's growing stronger and stronger, and it is. By freeing millions of Americans from this crushing debt of student debt, it means they can finally get on with their lives instead of their lives being put on hold.
Easing student debt is a key issue for young voters, many of whom have concerns over Biden's stance on the war in Gaza and fault him for not achieving greater debt forgiveness. Republicans have called Biden's approach to the issue an overreach of his authority. Former U.S. President Donald Trump tries to clear up his position on abortion, a key issue as he attempts to return to the White House. Trump says abortion laws should be determined by each state. He reiterates he backs exceptions for rape, incest, and to protect the life of the mother. But Trump stopped short of proposing a national ban that could have imperiled his chances with swing voters in the November election.
Many states will be different. Many will have a different number of weeks, or some will have more conservative than others, and that's what they will be. At the end of the day, this is all about the will of the people. You must follow your heart, or in many cases, your religion or your faith.
Trump has taken credit for a Supreme Court decision to eliminate a nationwide right to abortion. But the ruling has turned the issue into a political liability, with voter backlash credited with limiting Republican gains in the 2022 midterm polls. Now let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, DJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region.
We begin with vote counting in Los Angeles County, which has concluded a month since the primary elections. And leading the race for California's 52nd Assembly District is Filipino-American Jessica Caloza. The current Deputy Chief of Staff for PhilAm Attorney General Rob Bonta picked up 23,391 votes, nearly 3,000 more than second-place finisher Francisco Frankie Carrillo's 20,569 votes. Carrillo and Caloza will face off for the state assembly seat in the November general election.
Thank you so much to every single person who volunteered, who helped phone banked, who helped knock on a door, who donated, who contributed their time and their energy for helping us get across the finish line. Because of their support, we were able to make history this week, and we were the top vote getter.
If elected in November, Caloza would be the first Filipino woman in the state assembly and third Filipino overall. Since the primary elections, Caloza, Los Angeles' former Public Works Commissioner, has continued to be in the community, joining events and panels. She also continues to share her platforms on women's rights, working families, public schools, and addressing gun violence. We go to Canada, where the coming June 17, the Home Child Care Provider Pilot and the Home Support Worker Pilot, which started 5 years ago, will officially end. These two pilot programs gave qualified caregivers the option to bring their family with them to Canada and apply for permanent residence after 1 year of work experience. With the programs now coming to a close, the Vancouver Committee for Domestic Workers and Caregivers' Rights is concerned that caregivers who came in as temporary foreign workers will lose their pathway to permanent residency.
ang mga kababayan natin, mga Pilipino, ay maapektuhan yung mga nasa sa Temporary Foreign Workers Program sila. Dahil nga yung tungkol sa language requirement at saka yung education requirements at saka yung kanilang 1 year experience.
Diesta adds that the required post-secondary education and high language test scores have made it nearly impossible for potentially thousands of Filipino caregivers to apply for permanent residence. Still in Canada, 65 nurses from the Philippines who were among those recruited last year by representatives from the former government of Manitoba have already arrived and are working in different hospitals and healthcare facilities across the province. They're part of some 300 healthcare workers, including nurses, recruited to work in the province to help ease the challenges in the healthcare system. Gwen Le Bico, a registered nurse from Manila, was able to bring her husband and 3 children with her to Canada. Bico says the whole application process from interviews, exams, and assessments in the Philippines up to the time she arrived and started her training in Winnipeg was very smooth.
They have different orientation for internationally educated nurses. Mm-hmm. So what are how to be culturally sensitive? Since this is, we will be working with the diverse culture. Binigyan din po nila ako ng mentorship program so I can talk to somebody mm-hmm. kapag nagsastruggle po ako sa pag-adjust sa area.
Nursing assistant Casey Quiteriano is currently working as a healthcare aide in a nursing home.
It's okay for me to work, you know, as an HCA here. And mm-hmm. that's where I will gain experience. Mm-hmm. And then, and definitely, I know, I would definitely pursue my RN career naman po.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. Log on to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manato. Back to our friends at the Rundown.
Millions of sky watchers gazed upward for the first solar eclipse to grace North America in 7 years. Eclipse fans gathered in numerous places along for the path of totality, stretching from Mexico's Pacific coast through Texas and across 14 other U.S. states into Canada. Where clear skies prevailed, viewers were treated to a period of totality lasting up to 4.5 minutes, surpassing the duration of the 2017 eclipse in the U.S., which clocked in at under 3 minutes.
The moment when it just went dark and everything, I mean, it's the most beautiful thing I've seen. It really was a moment of, I was just amazed, blown away. I would travel to go find another one.
I think it's really cool. I never witnessed eclipse before. And they say it's not gonna happen again until like maybe 20 years or 100 years. So it will be once in a lifetime.
About 32 million people live within the path of totality in the U.S., with another 5 million estimated to have traveled for eclipse watching events.